Good afternoon to everyone of the participants for this second day program on the material testing, and it is being organized with our eminent personality from Anna University, Dr. Professor E. Natarajan, who is with the university and who is with the College of Engineering Guindy for so many years. And he will be introduced by one of our colleagues, and I request our colleague to start the program.
Good afternoon all. Today it's my pleasure to introduce our Dr. E. Natarajan sir, professor in mechanical engineering, director, Institute for Energy Studies, Dean, College of Engineering, Guindy, Anna University. Professor E. Natarajan secured his BE degree in mechanical engineering from Madras University with a gold medal for university first rank and M.Tech in thermodynamics, combustion and propulsion 1990 from mechanical engineering IIT Madras. He obtained his PhD degree in renewable energy from Anna University on biomass gasification through a sponsored project by Swedish International Development Agency, Sweden. During this program and research work, he has done many research studies in various laboratories in Sweden. The team guided by him won the prestigious international second prize for NASA in the year 2008 for a technical paper on design of transport aircraft for the future. He is currently involved in installation and performance testing of a pilot plant for solar drying of lignite at the Center for Applied Research and Development in NLC India Limited, Neyveli, for the project cost worth of 80 lakhs. He is also officiating as a director of Institute for Energy Studies and coordinator of AUNLCIL, that is Innovation Hub for Energy, Environment and Sustainability, established at IES with a seed fund of 4.96 crores by NLCIL for innovation product development through interested startups. He has edited a book on sustainable development. He has also authored a book on engineering thermodynamics and compiled steam tables for UG and PG students of engineering curriculum. His area of interest includes biomass gasification, solar, thermal and photovoltaic system, modeling and thermodynamic analysis of engineering systems, renewable energy based thermal and electrical plants, and energy efficient buildings. It's my pleasure and our honor to introduce our resource person for today's faculty development program. Sir, now it's time for your session to gain a valuable knowledge from today's resource person. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, good evening to all of you. I welcome you all for this presentation on testing of renewable energy systems. Again, my pleasant welcome to every one of you for this session on renewable energy systems testing. Let us understand that renewable energy has become the order of the day. We have been using energy from fossil fuels for quite long. We understood that fossil fuels are not going to last long. Even if fossil fuels are likely to last long, it is not going to be a wise decision for us to use this energy on two accounts. The systems based on fossil energy has limited efficiency. I would say cost-effective efficiency, limited cost-effective efficiency. Second one, they are highly polluting, putting the environment at danger, making sustainable development impossible. Hence, we have been very seriously thinking for various options, thereby renewable energy systems have been identified, invented, tested, and we started using. Over a period of time, we are very concerned about the reliability of renewable energy systems. Thereby, systematic methods have been developed for testing it to improve its reliability as well as durability. This presentation is going to focus on various testing methods and their reliability as well as some of their applications. We all know renewable energy is the energy produced from different sources that will last forever or for a very long period. The major examples include biomass energy, solar energy, wind energy, geothermal, and hydropower. Among them, biomass is the most important one, and it is one of the prominent renewable energy which we have been using from earlier days. Being an agricultural country, we have a lot of agricultural residues, forest residues, which can be put into better use. This biomass can be regenerated generation after generation so that we can continue to use without any depletion. It only requires a judicious planning and sustained use in such a way that biomass is generated at the same rate at which it is being consumed, which is quite possible. This biomass is available in different form. It is available in the form of wooden chips, wood pieces, wood powder, agricultural fibers and straws, briquettes, and so on. Water may be the form, they are very convenient to use so that a sustainable environment could be maintained. We all know biomass is the output of photosynthetic process. The material which is generated by photosynthesis could be combusted to release thermal energy. This thermal energy can be used for various forms of useful energies. It could be used for heating, it could be used for drying, it can be used for short power applications, it can also be used for generating electricity for our purposes. When it comes to utilization of biomass, there are two routes for biomass to be used. One is known as combustion, the other one is gasification. Let us recall, any fuel is basically an hydrocarbon. An hydrocarbon fuel, if it is mixed with sufficient quantity of oxidizer and burnt completely so that the thermal energy is released, it is called combustion. And hence, combustion is a process of complete chemical reaction of fuel with an oxidizer to release the energy available in the fuel. It is released in the form of thermal energy. So this thermal energy can be used either in furnaces or in kilns. Or this thermal energy can be used for converting liquid into vapor in steam generator. Then the steam generator can be used either for industrial processing or for generating shaft power, or the combination of these two. Any fuel requires certain quantity of oxidizer for its complete oxidation, what is known as combustion. Instead, if we supply the fuel with limited quantity of oxidizer, it is known as gasification. Basically, it is suggested that about 30% of oxidizer alone is supplied instead of 100% of oxidizer in order to convert solid fuel into a combustible gas. This combustible gas can be further be burned in a combustion chamber so that energy could be further released. Gasification is a method of partial combustion where solid fuel is converted into a combustible gas. There is a good amount of convenience for converting solid fuel into a gaseous fuel because the moment it becomes gaseous fuel, it can be conveniently used even in internal combustion engines. And hence, generating shaft power would become much, much easier. When it comes to gasification, there are different routes by which solid fuel can be converted into gaseous fuel. When a solid biomass fuel is heated in the absence of air or in the absence of any oxidizer, it is said to be pyrolysis. It leads to generation of medium energy gas, and sometimes we can even condense this gas and partly make into a pyrolysis oil. This will also produce a char, which is a concentrated carbon, which could be used for some other applications as well. So, thermal degradation of solid biomass fuel with the help of heat in the absence of oxygen or any other oxidizer is said to be pyrolysis. If the same biomass is gasified with air as medium, then it is said to be air gasification. If you take usually a typical biomass, for 1 kg of biomass, we need about 6 kg of air. Instead of 6 kg of air, if we supply only 2 kg of air, the solid fuel could be converted into a gaseous fuel known as producer gas. Basically, it is a low energy gas and it could be used for thermal applications. If the same biomass is partially oxidized with oxygen as an oxidizer, then this is said to be oxygen gasification. It is capable of resulting in medium energy gas. Instead of oxygen, hydrogen can also be used for oxidizing biomass. Cases, the basic idea is to supply limited quantity of oxidizer, which can be either air or oxygen or hydrogen. This the fuel into combustible gas, which can be either used for thermal application or for sharper application. As we said earlier, fuel is basically an hydrocarbon in nature. And these fuels are put to two different types of test to understand their suitability for a given application. One is said to be a proximate test, the other one is said to be an ultimate test. Under proximate test, the fuel is understood to be a composition of moisture, volatile matter, fixed carbon, and incombustibles. So, from the proximate test, one can understand the percentage of moisture in the fuel, volatile matter, fixed carbon, and incombustibles. Basically, these incombustibles are ash. If it is a raw biomass, there could be a large amount of moisture. If the moisture is present in the fuel in large quantity, then it should be dried before use. It is very difficult to use the fuel with large amount of moisture. Hence, drying becomes necessary. Lower the moisture, better the performance of the fuel. If the moisture present is considerably high, good amount of heat released in the combustion is used for drying the moisture itself, and hence the availability of useful energy will be relatively less. Volatile matter is basically a solid part of the fuel that can be converted into gaseous part with relatively low temperature, something like 150 degrees centigrade. So take any solid fuel, heat up the solid fuel up to 105 degrees centigrade. Whatever is released is said to be moisture. Moisture gets released around 100 degrees centigrade. If we heat up beyond 100 degrees centigrade, then volatile starts releasing. These are the easily evaporatable solid part of solid fuel. If the volatile matter is high, such a fuel can be easily volatiles are the matter that gets released and then it starts burning. Any fuel that doesn't contain enough amount of volatile is likely to be, unlikely to be easily ignited. For example, we have rice straw. In local language, we call it as vaikol. This rice straw contains more than 60% volatile matter, sometimes even more than 80%. That is the reason it's very easy to ignite haystack, rice straw bunch. The moment we preheat rice straw, it gives out combustible gases easily. It mixes with air and it starts burning. But if you take anthracite fuel, the amount of rice straw is even less than 1% in that. So igniting anthracite coal is extremely difficult. That's the reason when anthracite coal is used, initially, they use oil and ignite the furnace and bring the furnace to a certain temperature where anthracite is crushed and pumped into so that it can easily catch fire. Third component is fixed carbon. Fixed carbon is the carbon that remains relatively even at high temperature, and it shows the quality of fuel. Higher the carbon percentage, it's a good fuel. Any portion of solid fuel that cannot burn, even under high temperature condition, is just to be ash or incombustible. It should be as low as possible. So from the proximity test, one can understand the proportion of moisture volatile matter fixed carbon and incompressible present in the fuel. The next important test for biomass, or for that matter any solid fuel, is the ultimate test. Ultimate test is an elemental test meant for identifying the percentage of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur present by mass. When a kg of fuel is burned, the quantity of heat released is said to be heating value. When the fuel is burned, fuel becomes products. Fuel contains hydrogen and carbon mainly. Carbon becomes carbon dioxide, hydrogen becomes water. In the product, if water remains as water, the amount of heat released during this process is said to be higher heating value. However, we all know water cannot remain as water in such a high temperature atmosphere. Thereby, water evaporates to become vapor. Part of heat released during combustion is used for evaporating water into vapor. Thereby, the net amount of energy that is available for further usage is said to be low heating value. This table gives you the higher heating value of some of the common biomass fuels, starting from pitchwood, yellow pine, mango wood, and so on. You could see in terms of kilojoule per kg, it is the order of about 20 kilojoule per kg. Let's understand that hydrocarbon fuel, basically like petrol and diesel, have an heating value of about, higher heating value of about 48 megajoule per kg. But biomass fuel has about 20 megajoule per kg. It is even less than 50% of petroleum fuels. There's a major limitation of biomass fuel. However, they are environmentally friendly, suitable for sustainable development, and they are renewable in nature. And if you start using biomass over a period of time, we can become self-reliant. We don't have to depend on other countries for import of large amount of petroleum fuels. So these are the testing equipments used for various purposes. Thermogravimetric analyzer is used for conducting thermogravimetric analysis. It measures the variation of mass of the sample over time as the temperature changes. It can be used for predicting physical phenomena such as phase transitions, absorption, adsorption, and desorption, chemical phenomena, chemisorption, thermal desorption, and solid gas reactions, that is oxidation and reduction. This is one of the important tests that is conducted with solid fuel to understand their behavior during combustion and gasification. When we conduct TG analysis, we are plotting the variation of mass, that is weight, with respect to various temperatures. Thereby, we will know what is the minimum and maximum temperature required for converting this fuel into usable product. Moreover, it can also show the rate at which it can disintegrate. Thereby, we can plan the size of the combustion chamber, shape of the combustion chamber, and the requirement of primary air, secondary air, and so on. And another important equipment used for testing solid fuel is an elemental analyzer. Elemental analyzer is meant for calculating the elements present in the fuel and their quantity. Basically, fuels are analyzed for the presence of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, sulfur, and incombustibles. The quantum of heat released during the combustion of unit quantity of fuel is said to be heating value. Calorimeter is used for that purpose. Now, there is large amount of experiments that have been done in order to get correlations. There are highly reliable correlations which are available in order to calculate the heating value of the fuel even before going for real testing. Heating value is expressed in terms of the mass percentage of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, ash, sulfur, and nitrogen. So based on the element analysis, one can easily predict the calorific value or the heating value of biomass fuels and so on. When these fuels are used in gasifier or combustor, the rate of burning, combustibility, flammability limit, These kind of parameters have to be established, for which we need a complete combustion or gasification test setup. So these are all basically a chemical reactor fitted with suitable sensors so that it can be tested in a real reactor to understand their combustion phenomena. When combustion tests are conducted, one can understand the combustion and burnout behavior of solid fuels, composition of gaseous products from the fuel during biomass gasification and combustion, the quantum of energy or heat released, the behavior of ash forming compounds, and the first indications concerning ash melting behavior. In fact, behavior of the ash is one of the important parameter. If the ash is not dealt properly, probably it may lead to even complete corrosion of a reactor, leading to the premature failure of the system. Generally, combustion systems are designed for about 15 years of operation, in some cases up to 25 years of operation. And if the ash is not properly handled in the combustion chamber, then the life of the system may undergo a drastic reduction. Probably it may become even 1/10 of its life. The combustion chamber, which is meant for 10 years of life, may go terribly bad within a year. So there are many kinds of systems available for this purpose. There are fixed bed reactors where the solid fuels are fed and they are converted into combustible gas, and then they are burnt in the combustion chamber to release the thermal energy, which can be used further for converting water into vapor, and then you can use this vapor in the Rankine cycle for generating energy, and that could be this kind of fixed bed gasifiers. Or it can be a fluidized bed gasifier. This is one of the test setup what is available in our own laboratory, where a fluid bed gasifier can be used for particulate type of fuel like sawdust, rices, groundnut shell, and so on. And you can see the portion of green color tall reactor, which can be used for converting solid fuel into gaseous fuel. Then there is a gas cleaning system available for making it suitably clean and perfect. And then this gas can be fed into even a diesel engine as a substitute for diesel for generating electricity. So this is a test setup for granular fuels. Gasifiers could be of different type. It could be of downdraft gasifier, updraft gasifier, crossdraft gasifier, or open pore gasifier. Depending upon the nature, they are all suitable for different applications. Gasifiers can be used even for electricity generation, which is suitable for village electrification, captive power generation, grid-linked power generation, and they are highly suitable for thermal applications such as drying, of energy conversion in furnaces, kilns, high temperature applications in furnaces, kilns, etc. Updraft gasifiers are highly suitable for thermal application because it is capable of generating gas with higher heating value. However, the gas generated might not be clean enough to be used in shaft applications. And hence, the energy used, gas generated from updraft gasifier is highly suitable for furnace applications, something like cooking, drying, and so on. If it is a downdraft gasifier, this gasifier is capable of generating a reasonably clean gas, which can be used for even shaft power application. This gas can be used for operating gas engines, IC engines, and so on. And hence, it is suitable for high grid applications. Crossdraft gasifiers are highly suitable for varying demand, like blast furnaces, automobile applications, where the load changes from time to time. We can use this kind of gasifiers. When the fuel is in particulate form, like rices, sawdust, groundnut shell, chipped bagasse, then one can go for fluidized bed gasifiers or fluidized bed combustor. These are all different options. There was a time where small gasifiers were made or small combustors were made, experiments are being done. Now, people have tested and large-scale power plants are operating with biomass as a fuel. And there are power plants in the order of 300 to 600 megawatt capacity, where large quantity of biomass is available in a single place, maybe as an agricultural residue or a forest residue or a wood processing industry residue. Like if you have a shipbuilding industry or wood processing industry or paper pulp making industry or the wooden residues, biomass residues can be collected and can be used for generating large scale power. These are the examples for some of the agriculture residue utilizing biomass power plants. With the help of suitable transportation, all available agricultural residues in the surrounding area are collected and they are all mobilized to a single point. There you can chop them to a required size and shape and then feed them into a power plant for generating electricity. So this is a power plant where large amount of wooden chips that would be available from the wood processing industry and it can be used for power generation purpose. The prospects of using biomass as a fuel are as follows. It's a green energy. There is no net pollution from this kind of power plants. They are highly suitable for decentralized energy generation and it is the one of the promising future energy source, thereby one should be capable of using this kind of power plant. Following are the major limitations. The price of biomass is quite unstable, varying from season to season and from place to place, thereby making it very difficult to work out the cost of power generation. Lack of mechanization is the another major issue. Defragmented land holdings, thereby leading to an extensive cost for collection, mobilization and transport. And most of the farmers are having only small and marginal lands. Thereby, the process of collection becomes very, very complicated. However, needless to say, it is a very promising energy, much known technology, quite suitable for countries like this. Thereby, we must investigate this and then try to use this to the extent possible so that we less depend and the other sources of fuel. The next promising source of energy is the solar energy. And there are direct methods and indirect methods. Under direct methods, thermal applications and photovoltaic applications are very popular. Let us see various methods used for testing of solar thermal systems. In fact, among solar applications, thermal systems were the first one which were developed. And now there are very specific procedure for testing these thermal systems. There are preliminary evaluation tests, and when there is no sun, how the system behaves, probably something like in a night, so there is a no solar test, and as well as when sun is present, how the system behaves, and that is said to be a solar test. Thereby, the test for which solar systems are subjected are classified under three category: preliminary test, no solar test and solar test. We are going to see a couple of them. See, this is a solar thermal collector. Basically, solar thermal collector is a rectangular plate coated with a selective absorber, which absorbs sunlight and converts that into thermal energy. Thereby, the plate becomes hot. The cold working fluid is pumped through the solar panel, solar collector, so that it generates hot air or hot liquid, and this hot liquid is collected in a tank and used for different applications. Basically, we use very highly thermal conducting material for this purpose, and you could see there are copper tubes through which working fluid could rise. These copper tubes are fitted with fins for increasing the surface area. These fins are coated with selective material so that absorption becomes very high. And these are the collectors what are used for collecting solar energy to generate hot liquid. Basically, they are rectangular plates fitted with fins and copper tubes for converting solar thermal energy into a thermal energy of working fluid. This is how they basically look like. You can see the riser tubes on the surface. There will be a downator for receiving the cold working fluid. There is a upator for collecting all the hot fluid. And when these tubes are made, and it results in converting solar energy into hot one, there is a small video for you to understand how this configuration looks like. You could see there are two copper tubes used at the bottom and top. One is going to be a downator, the other one is going to be a topator. These are the risers. These risers have to be welded properly with the downator and topator. Thereby, it should be tested for any leakage. So there are typical testing methods, NDT methods for leak-proof test. Hello. Yeah, there are different types of solar collectors. Something like stationary collectors, single axis stacking collectors, multiple axis stacking collectors. So depending upon the type of thermal collector, it could be either a stationary collector or single axis tracking collector or two axis tracking collector. In fact, if you use stationary collector, you will get only low temperature in the order of something like 80 degree. If you go for single axis tracking collector, it can go up to something like 400 degree centigrade. If you go for two axis tracking collector, the temperature can be as high as 2000 degree centigrade. To draw your attention, even in solar collectors, there is a possibility to go up to a temperature of 2000 degree centigrade. It is a marvelous technological development among solar thermal collectors. So these are the various applications. You can use it for boiler applications, thermal applications, cleaning applications, drying applications, and so on. So we can use all the solar collectors for all agricultural drying processes. So there are agricultural producers which needs to be processed when they are produced in large quantity, so that you can preserve them for higher demand days. So these are all the collectors which you can use. So this is our Nana University project installed for Neyveli for drying lignite. Lignite has 50% of moisture when it comes in mines. So this lignite can be dried. This is a scheme which we have generated, and then we have presented to NLC India Limited Neyveli. Then we have put up a power plant there, and this power plant is a pilot plant. This pilot plant is in operation now for their drying of lignite. And this is a 2-year project. This project is going to continue till October of this year. And this pilot plant is meant for converting raw lignite into a dried lignite. These are all evacuated tube air collectors where hot air of 140 degree centigrade can be generated with the help of, in addition to this air collector, we have a compound solar collector also. With the help of which you can generate hot air at 140 degree centigrade for the purpose of drying lignite. Another important application of solar energy is generation of electricity with the help of photovoltaic cells. Remember, basically, photovoltaic cell is a semiconductor material for converting solar energy into electricity. So there are monosilicon solar cells, polysilicon solar cells. Monosilicon solar cells are efficient, but they are costly. Polysilicon solar cells are cheaper, but they are less efficient. And these cells are capable of generating electricity. For all these cells, we always generate, test it for IV characteristics, popularly known as current voltage characteristics. So when there is no load, the amount of current generated is said to be short circuit current. When there is, zero amount of current flowing, the voltage is said to be an open circuit voltage, meaning the circuit is open and there is no flow of current. As the voltage changes, power also varies. At certain voltage, power is maximum. This is said to be a maximum power point. Now there are very convenient tools which are available for testing this purpose. When we superimpose both of them, the curve comes like this. So whenever a solar photovoltaic system is installed, it is tested for an IV characteristics. And that is the variation of current versus voltage. I have an interesting video to have a look at it. Yes. Probably about 2 decades before, these kind of systems are not available. Now you could see how voltage and currents are tested for this kind of system.
This is the Solar PV150 from Seawood, the world's first multifunction PV installation tester featuring SolarLink. It's part of a full test kit that includes everything required to test to IEC 62446. This film demonstrates how easy it is to use the Solar PV150 on a PV installation. First, pair the Survey 200R and the PV150 units. This allows us to view real-time irradiance readings on the PV150, display and store irradiance and temperature measurements alongside our corresponding electrical test results. To pair the instruments, we press and hold the on-off keys on the Survey 200R. On the PV150, press and hold the RPE and auto keys. Keep both buttons pressed. When the PV150 has successfully paired, it will beep and display the serial number of the Survey 200R. The PV150 is now paired and ready to display irradiance data from the Survey 200R. Now we simply press and hold the temperature and hold keys on the Survey 200R to put it into transmit mode. A triangle.
Well. These links are available for you later also, you can have a look at it. I would like to tell you that in olden days, when we install a solar photovoltaic system with multimeter, we have to make individual measurements and then we have to make a graph like this. Now there are compact test meters are available. You just like plug and play, like computer, you can just plug into the system. It will tell you what is your short circuit current and what is open circuit voltage. And it will draw IV curve for you, and it will tell you what will be the condition under which it will operate for producing maximum power. You can collect all this data with the help of this meter, and then you can interface it with your laptop. You can transfer all the data to your laptop also. We have a few more interesting videos, so I have to take a break here and continue with my presentation so that I can show you other videos also, and you can have a look at them at a later stage. So there is a complete possibility for analyzing all these performances. As I told you, you could see the maximum power point identified in blue color letter. And these kind of meters can tell you what is the condition under which the system can be operated in order to harvest maximum power from this kind of systems. So this kind of solar cells are converted into modules. Modules are converted into panels. Panels are converted into arrays, whereby they can be planted on the surface of the roof. And it can be used for generating electricity either for domestic application. When domestic need is not there, you can export this energy to the grid. They are all quite possible. In fact, in 1996 itself, Indian Renewable Energy Development Agency had a program under which we were all trained, and they took us to US to show all the possible solar energy systems. Now, all the systems have been well perfected. And we have been installing in thousands and thousands of kilowatts everywhere. We have many megawatt systems available in Tamil Nadu itself. There are good amount of testing stations, what is available in various parts of India. These PV modules are tested for electrical characteristics, mechanical load test behavior, and climate test also. These are the different tests, what is required for all of them. Panel is usually tested for a condition called NOCT. This stands for normal operating cell temperature condition. So these are the typical parameters under which the panel is to be tested. Then the panel has to be put to better use. When a PV panel is used for any particular application, it has to qualify a set of tests, UV exposure test, and diode test, and different tests. I have listed them down. And it has to undergo a thermal cycling test, dynamic mechanical test, enhanced hotspot test, and system voltage stability test, and so on. These are the various tests what is to be done. In fact, for thermal application, there are different types of concentrated collectors also. All these concentrated collectors can produce relatively higher temperature. All industrial applications, for all industrial applications, you can use them. These kind of parabolic collectors can produce hot fluid at a temperature of around 400 degrees centigrade. The combination of all of them can be used for many industries like sugarcane industry, jaggery industry, and for many of the processing industries, thermal processing industries. They are the highly suitable one. This is Fresnel cell based. I mean, thermal collector, and these are dish collector. These are the various thermal collectors which can be used. These thermal collectors could be either in the form of heliostats also. So large number of meters kept in a field farm so that they can receive solar energy and reflect the solar energy onto the tower so that very high temperature can be generated in the receiver. This is a case where receiver fluid temperature can go up to even 2000 degrees centigrade. It can occupy hundreds of acres of land like this. However, it is capable of producing very high temperature working fluid suitable for large scale power generation like 100 megawatt or even 200 megawatt. In fact, when it comes to a panel,
in recent years, KDI has invested in developing various types of PV solar test equipment to meet the needs of manufacturers as well as accredited laboratories of solar cell and PV modules. Our test equipment guarantees that the processing of solar cells and modules meets international quality standards. KDI is also an internationally qualified supplier with IEC testing equipment. It is a fact that all of our energy comes from the sun. Now we can assess the performance parameter conditions. When testing, we immerse the module in a large tank, exerting a voltage.
Nowadays, well-established test beds have been designed and there are number of test labs in India itself where we can test our solar panels for their individual performances. Another important renewable energy system is the wind energy system, and Tamil Nadu is one of the topmost wind energy producing state after Gujarat. We have an international attention for our wind energy programs, thereby large amount of wind energy testing stations are available, and quite naturally we have National Institute of Wind Energy in Chennai.
Okay, so this is
you can see
small
the wind testing machine as well.
Fantastic setup. Where we've hired out one of these large industrial warehouse cooling fans, which will move something like 37,000 meters cubed of air per hour. So it has a pretty high airflow. It's the biggest one that we could find. So we can try and simulate some of the higher wind speeds. We can actually get about 25, 26 mile an hour wind out of this at full power. So just a bit of an explanation of how I've set up this test rig. We've got this massive fan which blows at the small 100 watt turbine. It's not actually a perfect airflow out of this fan. It tends to have a very high wind speed around the edge of it, and near the center of the fan is a much lower wind speed. So in reality, the airflow is going to be a lot more equal when it hits the turbine blade. When it hits the center part of these turbine blades, then that's what starts off the initial turning of the wind turbine. So we've got turbine is fitted onto a 48 mm.
In fact, the minimum wind speed what is required for starting the wind machine is to be a cut-in speed. So they have a wind simulator and send the air at different speed, and they want to identify the minimum speed which is required for starting the wind machine. And these kind of testing units are made. And moreover, when we make it as a complete wind turbine, there is a separate procedure for testing that as well. Similarly, wind blades are very large. They also be tested for vibration and other things. This short video shows how wind turbines are tested.
Hi, I'm Tom Green, your host here on ETV, back with another NECA IBEW video on this award-winning website. Wind turbines are popping up all over the United States, and we've shown you stories on how the NECA IBEW team trains their craftsmen and women on wind turbine installations, and then a couple of job-specific videos where those skills are put to the test. And just as important as the installation is the equipment. Wind turbine blades spin and cut through the air at incredible speed, with incredible force. You ever wonder how they're tested to ensure that they'll stand up to that stress? Dominic Ceritano has our story today from Charlestown, Massachusetts.
Today's wind turbines are modern marvels. They sweep across vast landscapes, just waiting to spin into action. And along with all the intangibles a wind turbine brings, what's becoming more and more critical to every manufacturer is making sure the blade.
So you can understand, the wind turbine is designed for 20 years of life, and they usually test it within 2 weeks time or maximum of 2 months time. So this kind of rigorous testing is made, and I have given the links of other testing methods also, and as you find time you can go through them. Initially we have been using renewable energy systems for small applications where the testing were not much demanding. Now we started using for even high-end applications, thereby it demands for very rigorous testing. Now we have very established procedure for all of them. This kind of testing is basically demanded for the purpose of improved reliability, which is very, very important for all of us. Unless otherwise, the reliability and durability of these kind of systems are established, it becomes very difficult for industrial applications. Hence, well-established procedures have been made, and testing stations are installed in different parts of India, and we have mechanism to get it tested quite easily. So let us understand that these kind of testing procedures are going to make sure that these kind of machines are going to rule the roost in future. Renewable energy is the scope for the sustainable future. Hence, testing and validation of the equipments only can ensure better performance, reliability, and durability. So we must put all these renewable systems to a better use through this kind of testing procedure and I hope that we can take the opportunity, the next possible best opportunity to install renewable energy system for our day-to-day applications. And I am representing Institute for Energy Studies as director, and College of Engineering Guindy has been, and any help required, either in terms of design, development, and installation, maintenance, you are all welcome to approach me, and we'll be very happy to extend this any possible help. And I am very thankful to the organizers for giving me this opportunity. And let me thank every participant also for actively participating in this. Thank you, Ananda.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable presentation. Now, dear participants, now it's time for your question and answer session. Please post in our chat box so that we can raise your questions to our presenter. Sridhar, sir, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Please enable the chat box, sir. Sridhar, sir, please read out the questions.
A very good afternoon, Professor, sir.
Very good afternoon.
Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your knowledge on the developments of novel technologies for optimum energy production from the available natural resources. It was very interesting indeed. I hope all the participants agree with me.
It's a pleasure to know that.
So I would read up the questions posted by the participants for further discussion. The first question is from R. Praveen. Sir, biomass contains octane number or cetane number?
Actually, biomass is a solid fuel. This octane number and cetane number are the quality parameters used only for petroleum products. In fact, you can produce combustible gas from the solid biomass. You can convert that into liquid fuel also. It is suitable for diesel engines. Thereby, I would say it is more suitable for diesel engine. Thereby, it has relatively higher cetane number octane number. In other words, the fuel that is generated from biomass is highly suitable for diesel applications, thereby it is more compatible with the diesel engine applications.
Thank you, sir. Mr. Kamaljit Motia is asked why renewable energy is costly.
In fact, renewable energy doesn't require any maintenance for about 20 years. For example, if I buy a solar water heater for home, I have to spend about 25,000 rupees. But I don't need to do anything for the next 25 years. Instead, if I buy a electrical geyser, it costs me only 5,000 rupees. But understand that every month you have to pay 1,000 rupees or 2,000 rupees additional electricity bill. So renewable energies are, initial cost is only high. The overall levelized cost is comparatively very, very low. Most of the time, developing countries like us will have a difficulty in spending in a large quantity as an initial investment. That's a problem. So let's understand that only the initial cost is high, the overall cost is still low, and moreover it is highly environmentally friendly, for which we do not put any cost.
Sir, one more question. Mr. Tamimul Ansari has asked how the testing facility and other resources can be used by affiliated institution students.
In fact, now the much easier one, all renowned institutions have the list of facilities available in their website. If you do not have that list available in the website, there is a state nodal agency. In Tamil Nadu, there is an agency called Tamil Nadu Energy Development Agency. Every state, there is a state nodal agency. At central level, there is Ministry of New and Renewable Sources of Energy. You can just write to them about what kind of facility you require. They will tell you where you can do the testing. You can write to them and they will facilitate it. If there is any such difficulty, I will ask the organizer to share my email ID. Please mail it to me. I will give you enough support and I will tell you from where you can get the test done. And then I can also tell you, I can also facilitate that from my side.
Sir, one more question. Can we use renewable energy sources for charging electrical vehicles?
Yes, very much. We can do that.
Sir, how leaking of copper pipe is tested?
In fact, they will put it to a pressure of 10 times higher pressure than the operating pressure. They will apply a soap solution over the surface and they will look for the bubbles. That's a physical testing. Other than that, the pressure testing can also be done.
Sir, is biomass is effective for large power production?
Yes, quite naturally. Now there are power plants available with 300 to 600 megawatt capacity.
Sir, one more question. Time to find out the HCV and LCV, high calorific value and low calorific value for gaseous fuel, which formula we have to use?
In fact, there is a Junkers formula available. I can share the formula also. For gaseous fuels, see, we know the heating value of individual gaseous component, and then you know the proportion. There's a linear combination of these gases. Correspondingly, you can calculate for gaseous fuel. In fact, it is only difficult to do that for solid fuel. That is the reason you have a Dulong-Petite formula. For gaseous fuel, you can use a linear combination formula for calculating the heating value of the gaseous fuel.
Sir, last question. Which is the better renewable energy source, solar or wind, in hilly areas?
In fact, when there is no wind flow available, even in hilly areas, we cannot use wind energy. Solar is good for quite good amount of time. Thereby, when we compare these two, solar energy is the better one.
Sir, one question posted like, what is the difference between gravimetric analysis to volumetric analysis for gaseous fuel?
In fact, in terms of volume, if you work out the presence, that is percentage, that is said to be volumetric analysis. For example, I take 100 meter cube of gas, out of which, how much is the particular gas available? If it is 15 meter cube, we write it as 15%. In term, when you say gravimetric analysis, it refers to the total weight present in terms of individual gas. Thereby, gravimetric analysis based on the mass present, volumetric analysis based on the volume present. That is what the major difference is.
So, one more last question. Can we extract hydrogen from biomass and use it for combustion for automobiles?
Quite possible, but the amount of hydrogen present in the biomass is very less. Thereby, it will not be economically feasible, but practically and technically possible. Maybe we have to stop this. I have another meeting starting in another few minutes. And probably you can share my email ID with the participants. They can right away write to me. I can answer them as well.
Thank you very much, sir, for sharing your knowledge on the developments of novel technologies for optimum energy production from the available natural resources. I hope
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
I hope all the participants got their questions answered. With this discussion, we would conclude today's session.
Hello.
With this discussion, we would conclude today's session. I sincerely thank our management and our secretary, Madam Dr. K.S. Babai, for giving us the opportunity to host this webinar session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.